if you read this tutorial or look at some of my videos, you'll find I'm always harping about the preparation phase. And a big part of that is just deciding on simple things like the file formats that you're going to use. And in that discussion, you have to consider whether or not you're going to have to export this model at the end to different file formats. And you know, there's some obvious reasons why. For example, if you're going to export to a file format that doesn't support edge weighting, then you can't really use it in your model because it'll be a different shape when you export it. Now the same goes for a lot of these things that we think of as Boolean operations. So let me give you the opposite example, which is that if you know for a fact that you can stay within MODO for the lifetime of your use of this model, then there are some alternatives to some rather complicated subdivision surface modeling that you can use. So let me just give you a few examples of those here. I have an image that's currently covering up the render window here, and as you can see, it's a long thin image. It was actually created by rendering another version of this model that was further along, and then I just used the alpha mask from that render to create this image. And so it's all black and the window openings are white. So we can use that in at least two different ways. The way that you're seeing it here, here's the material. The base material is very simple, shiny white metal material that's used throughout the model. And then the image just above it is applied to a very simple X projection UV map. And in this particular mode, you're seeing it in the stencil mode here. And the material properties are all just the defaults. And we can also change that to diffuse color. That gives us method number two. Diffuse amount is what the setting would be. And because it's a black image with white openings, we want to invert that in the case of using it for a diffuse amount. Now obviously, this is kind of a standard UVing technique, so it doesn't have to be a black and white image like this. You can include all kinds of color information, and you can include panel lines and markings and all kinds of things. But if you have the capability to create these images pretty quickly, and maybe you're good at Photoshop, then it's a great way to prototype. Because if your customer is the type who might change their mind about what shape these windows should be, or how many they should be, or where the door should go, or whatever, you can prototype all these with images before you start modeling. So it's a very handy sort of process. Now I'm going to turn off that material just so it doesn't affect this next example. One of the other tools that we have now is render booleans. So we take our simple fuselage here, and I've just used the actual windows from the aircraft and extruded those across the x-axis. You'll notice that the cabin window item back here isn't centered, but these windows are uniform shape across the x-axis, so I just didn't bother. It won't affect the render boolean in any way. So when we turn on the render boolean, this is the effect. Very nice, and again, it's a slightly more realistic way of portraying some of these openings and saves you a ton of modeling time. Of course, now we have a brand new tool, which is Mesh Fusion. And the beauty of Mesh Fusion, of course, is not only the editability, but the instant feedback that you get. So when you're within Mesh Fusion, you can take any of these items, let's say some of these polygons for the window geometry, and you can select all of them, of course, or you can just select some of them. You could do a variety of things here. You could duplicate this and move it to a different location if your customer wanted more windows, or you could just move the existing ones. Of course, you have all the usual options with scaling these, using falloffs, and so on. But the beauty of it is the instant feedback and the ability to just save this file as it is and come back and edit it at any time. So if your customer is making a lot of changes, it's a great way to do some prototyping. Now there are a couple of things that you're going to have to do once you are ready to export this file. You're going to have to freeze it, which you can do in Mesh Fusion, and you end up with the object that looks just like what you saw in the preview version. And then obviously if you're going to use this as a scale model, you'll want to come in here and delete these interior polygons, and that's very simple to do. Now once you've done that, this object then is exportable to other formats, unlike either the render booleans or perhaps, depending on the software, the stencil mask options. The catch, if you will, with mesh fusion is that you do end up with a mesh like this. There's not a single thing wrong with it in terms of its rendering quality. It's very high quality that way. But it is a frozen mesh. It's not Catmull Clark Subdivision Surfaces anymore. Right now, it's about 62,000 polygons. And if we were to place it into Psubs mode, then you get over 1 million polygons. And that's a pretty dense mesh considering what this object is. Now, the other thing about mesh fusion is that once you've frozen this object and it's not a P-sub item anymore with all quads, then you're going to have difficulty doing other mesh fusion operations on it. So if you wanted to create a variety of openings, not just these window openings, but perhaps the cabin doors, landing gear doors, baggage door, and so on, you'd have to do that in one mesh fusion operation and then go and delete these interior polygons. Mesh fusion is a beautiful tool, and later on in this tutorial I'll be showing you some practical applications that I've been using it for prototyping injection molded parts, and it's been working just wonderfully for that. So we'll come back to this, but in the meantime I just wanted to show you some Boolean alternatives that will work if you're going to stay within MODO.